Oh my goodness. Easing into it. The Unity Band. Mike Barrett, Randy Winters, Mark O'Keefe. Well, good morning, everyone. Welcome here at New Thought Unity Center. Welcome to everyone that's in this wonderful place, as well as those that are watching from their wonderful place, right? We all belong together no matter where we are. So, speaking of we belong together, our opening song is one by Garth Brooks and Stephanie Davis. No wall to divide us, no matter how high. Ain't no storm to untie us, all it may try. We're all leaves on the same tree, under one sky. Don't let nobody tell you. We are sister and brother, born to love one another. It's whispered by the wind to all living things. It's in every sunrise. It's what the wild birds sing. It shines in newborn. Won't be torn. We belong to each other. We are sister and brother. Born to love one another. Travelers on a bus ride home. Yeah, we laugh and cry, we rise and fall. Yeah, we fuss and fight, but through it all, we belong to each other. We are sister and brother, born to love one another. We belong to each other. We are sister and brother, born to love one another. We are all leaves on the same tree.
Good. Thank you for that beautiful introduction to today, that reminder that we belong together. We honor everyone who is here, and I can see your eyes, and everyone who is here, and I can't see your eyes, but we are all together. If you need any more confirmation that there is evolution and delightful progress happening, consider the notion that right now this internet, which only has existed for a few decades, is bringing millions of people together all across the country and world who can't otherwise be together. And that's an extraordinary thing. So whether in person or just in, not just in, but in your hearts as well, we are together, and that's where we belong. Let's start with our affirmation for today. When we come together, it is in order to remind ourselves of the strength and the glory. We open our minds with this thought: my mind is filled with thoughts that bring love, light, and truth to my life. Say that with me wherever you are.
My mind is filled with thoughts that bring love, light, and truth to my life.
And let us pray. Mother, Father, God, thank you. We find ourselves in the midst of extraordinary love. We find ourselves beacons of insatiable light, invincible light, powerful light, healing, transforming, beautiful light. We know that by accepting the glory of God's power through us, by investing in God's brothers and sisters around us, and by delighting in the unconditional love that is us, we facilitate the creation, the evolution, and the change that we all seek. The result is peace, love, prosperity, and joy. And for this and the process of getting to this, we are grateful. Amen.
Amen. All right, it's time for a congregational because we are so thankful.
Please stand
with us.
Thank you for this day, Spirit. Thank you for this day. Thank you for this day, Spirit. Thank you for this day. This healing, this healing.
Whether at home or in this space, wherever you are, to honor those who are around you in whatever way is best. If you're at home, take advantage of the chat and the comments and say hello. Share a message. Call someone out who you're glad to see is also with you in that context, in that digital presence. And thank you to everyone who is here and working and doing all the amazing things. As I said before, the last time I was here, you could see just from here up the amazing amount of love and gratitude that we all have for being in the presence.
Mm-hmm. All right, so are we going to do our mission and vision?
Yes.
After.
Let's do it. After do we want, let's do you. Let's be unity.
Oh,
in
my,
song.
My bad.
Two, three, whatever.
Yeah, that's right. Let's get that red.
Because it's that musical reminder that be who you are, you have permission. If you've ever been anywhere or been on a website anywhere or tuned into a congregation anywhere where you felt like perhaps you were not welcomed or not honored for being exactly who you are, then know that here we love you unconditionally for being the amazing, awesome person exactly who you are. Thank you for being here. You're welcome, and also wherever you might be on your spiritual path, we invite you to come along and walk with us. We work from fundamental statements. One of them is our mission statement, and it's appearing now. And let's say it together. In God, we are an inclusive, abundant community, experiencing love, transforming lives, and serving others. And we have a vision, too, where we're going. We celebrate a world of harmony and oneness, a place of loving stewardship, sacred connections, and pure joy, where all are welcomed with honor and respect. And so it is. Have a seat, and there's probably some business and announcements and that sort of thing. Let's do that too.
So yes, once again, everyone is welcome here, and we do have events that are going on as we speak, and will be coming in the future. Speaking of, a Sufi celebration of divine love. August 5th at 6:30 to 8 o'clock, Ancient News will again celebrate Sufi divine love with poetry, prayer, song, meditation, and movement.
Women of Wisdom Summertime Joy Workshop on Zoom will be July 18th at 10 a.m. You can get the Zoom link from the email blast, or call Susan at NTUC Unity. And the email information will be forwarded to you.
And of course, karaoke. So we love to have fun and sing with DJ Kimbaloo. And woo-hoo, that's coming up August 7th at 7 p.m. It's always on the first Friday of the month. So come and just have fun.
A Course in Miracle meets on Thursday evening on Zoom at 6:30. And the group is facilitated by Susan Bartels, our very own. So if you wish to join the group, just call her and she'll give you the information.
And board nominations. Nominations are now being accepted for two board positions here at New Thought Unity Center. If interested, talk to Peggy Wyan or fill out the application on the New Thought Unity website.
NTUC email blast. The very best way to stay on top of everything going on at New Thought Unity Center is to receive the weekly email blast. If you're not on the list already, call Susan at 513-961-2527 and you'll be added to the list to receive the good news that's going on here at New Thought Unity Center.
That's right. So those are the announcements for the morning. But now we've got time to go to a wonderful place of quietness and stillness. So if you wouldn't mind just settling in your seat, on the floor, at home, just getting to a quiet place, let your mind rest.
Surely the presence of God is in this place. I can feel God's mighty power and grace. I can hear the rush of angels' wings
meditate to reconnect with Source. We actively choose in order to remind ourselves in this very intentional moment of the power and strength that lies within and can be made without. I invite you to take a deep breath and release. And wherever you are, as you release your breath, allow your body to relax, gravity to settle you into whatever piece of furniture or pose you may be in. Place your feet flat on the floor or uncross your legs. Take all things from your hands. If it feels right to you, close your eyes or otherwise divert your attention in order to facilitate the journey within. And take a deep breath. And release.
Oh,
What's the topic today? Sorry. No, what's the title today? I know the topic. The title is Game Changers, Three Big Truths You Have to Be to Believe. And so it seems like I'm going to talk about three very important things. And I need to begin by letting you know that I'm not. I'm going to talk about one very important thing. Because I am learning to self-edit. And those of you who know that I mean, we've been together more than a year now, that occasionally, once in a while, I can tend to go a little long. And when I started to think about these three game changers, the big things that have struck me over the course of my journey, and then I started to kind of outline out how I'd like to illustrate each one, and then I thought about how important they are and that they're pretty big, they're game changers. Cramming three would either keep us here way into our brunch or would be way too much information. So we're going to do one, and then next week we'll do number two, or next time in 2 weeks, and then the next time after that we'll do the third one. So this is great. So if you see this same graphic popping up on the blast email or whatever, just know it's not a typo. I've just decided to make the summer easier for all of us, and now we just know what we're going to talk about for the next three times. So we got one today. The other thing I need to let you know is that at our house yesterday morning, we drove and brought home an adorable little puppy named Gus. That has nothing to do with anything else I'm talking about today, but I found that the dog is unbelievably adorable, and you should go to my Facebook page or to my Instagram, the author David Allen Brown, and see the dog because it will make you happy. And so that's all I have to say about that, but just so you know, Gus has arrived in our house. He is a mini labradoodle, and he's about this big and about this wide. He's kind of a rectangle shape, and he's hilarious because he's a true toddler. They don't actually run like dogs run. He just hops like a bunny all the time. It's just, it's crazy. Anyway, like I said, that has nothing to do with anything. But we need things to make us happy, don't we? So, as I said, there were three original things that came to me, and I wrote them down together, and I called them game changers. And for me, in my spiritual journey, they were the game changers. They were the things that I read and had to stop and breathe and be, wait a minute, what? That I found were the focus of both intense concentration and discovery for myself and of great transformation when I integrated them into the thinking and the manner in which I brought my Christ consciousness into play. And it's not a typo. It's not things you have to see to believe. It's things you have to be to believe, which is another reason why I wanted to allow us time to breathe into them after I introduced them, to give us time to work with them one at a time as you go through. Because these are things you want to actually start thinking about, start injecting in as you use your light. So I was introduced to this book. It's called This Flowing Towards Me, and it's written by Marilyn Lacey, who's a Catholic nun who for much of her career ended up working directly and hands-on with refugees around the world. She answered an ad on a bulletin board to host a refugee family when she was younger, and they arrived at the airport unable to speak English. She got a few instructions from the coordinator, and then they went home with her, and she nurtured and cared for them. This was a calling that then sent her around the world into some of the deepest and darkest and most difficult circumstances on our planet. And though she is and continues to be and entered into a service of God that she knew and understood, that she was conscious of, that she accepted and studied and prayed and worked hard, what she found was that the very sight and integration of this much devastation and desperation and dislocation and disrespect began to wear down on her ego self and her psyche. And over the course of many years, she did, as so many of us have done, she entered into prayer, sought the answers from God, wanted to dialogue with God themselves and say, what is it? Why aren't you answering? Why is this happening? What is this occurring for? What is the reason? And over years found that she could not hear, much to her frustration, the conversation that she so wanted to have with Holy Spirit. And yet she continued her work, and she admits straight out in the book, and became more and more frustrated, and then more and more angry with God. How can this be happening, and why won't you explain to me or help me know why this was happening? And after many years, she found herself again asking the question in prayer. And in her book, she offers this analogy. Suppose you had a brother who you love, I said to God, asking the question of God. Suppose your father lavished abundant gifts on you, but gave nothing to your brother who you love. In fact, he locked him out in the backyard and ignored him, leaving only a small bowl for scraps for him to eat once a day. How could you continue to enjoy all of your own comforts and privileges inside the house? And how long could you abide praying for this brother from a distance? And how long before you would begin to resent this father that supposedly loves all of his children? And yet this happens. And so often, we ask this question. And this time, after years of wondering, after being open, after being well taught the course of listening, so then did she find herself in dialogue. Much to my surprise, God replied. You know that's not how it is, Marilyn, though I understand why you feel this way. I have many children, and some of them locked your brother out of the house. My heart is out there with him, but I've left people free, and they do as they please. You see, God speaking, love can't force anything. I'm God speaking, as powerless really as a quadriplegic. They surround me with linen and candles, with solemn processions and profusions of flowers, and they deluge me with their prayers, but oddly enough, only a few of them really take notice of their brothers and sisters. It breaks my heart too. What an image that is. For those of us who from time to time create a manifestation of God in human form, for God to infuse into this holy woman's mind the image of God as a paraplegic, as someone who all these adornments, all of these linens, all of these flowers, all of these sent messages land at the feet of God and stay there. And as a pastor, a friend of mine in Indianapolis said, what if it's as if God isn't quite as almighty as we thought? And this is a game changer. This is a fundamental difference between a culture that has for many centuries sat back and waited for God to make the difference. And yet, Course in Miracles tells us, and this is the game changer, God himself is incomplete without me. This one took me a while. God himself is incomplete without you. You must engage. Remember this phrase, when the ego speaks. So immediately Course in Miracles knows that there's a big side of us that's like, whoa, ho, 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 ho. I don't know where you're getting this notion that you are, you know, godlike. But let's just all settle down a little bit. Course in Miracles immediately says, so when the ego speaks, remember this phrase, God himself is incomplete without you. The truth about you is so lofty that nothing unworthy of God is worthy of you. We kick the ego aside and say, you know what? I'd never say that God was weak. You know what? I'd never say that God isn't good enough. I'd never say that God's misspoken. I'd never say that God sinned. I'd never say that God couldn't do it. And so I can't say that about myself any longer. Because God is incomplete without you, because his grandeur is total. We're good at that. We're good at understanding the grandeur of God. We've been taught that, we've been shown that, we've built temples to it. And when you enter into that knowledge, you step forward confidently in order to make the change and to create something new and to make a difference in the world. Later, Course in Miracles says, without you, there would be a lack in God, a heaven incomplete, a son without a father. There could be no universe. There could be no reality. And on some level, my ego grabbed a hold of that. That's right. This chair wouldn't exist without human beings. This flag wouldn't exist without human beings. This building wouldn't exist without human beings. Miracles wouldn't exist without human beings. We are the conduits of God on earth. That was the initial start, the game changer for me. That's right. If I don't enact it, it won't happen. Who else is going to do it? I mean, I think my puppy has pretty strong, you know, ability to transform just the 6 hours I spent with him. So do I. So do all living things. That amazing ability to accept the responsibility to be loving, to be creationary, and to be forgiving. To the power with. Of all of the things that you can do, of all of the powers we assign to the loving God, these are the ones that we access instantly and immediately at any time with as much validity as the whole has, as God has. Because we've been taught that too. Well, you can forgive, but really it'll be somebody else, you know, the final forgiveness. Thank you for forgiving me, but I'll wait and see what God has to say. Thank me for forgiving myself. I wonder if God agrees. That's that notion of separation. The game changer is there is no separation. When you forgive, it is God forgiving. When you love, it is God loving. When you create, it is God creating. And we have to accept the responsibility of that. That we have created where we have come to. That we have created all that is happening. And while that seems daunting, we are also the answer. Everything we have created, if it's not what we want, we are also the answer to creating what we do want. There's this extraordinary story later in this book. During World War II, a remarkable network of hospitality opened in France for Jews who were fleeing Nazi Germany, and a married couple started this movement in a town called Les Chablons, which I'm sure I'm saying wrong, the internet will tell me. Their village became the safest place in Europe for Jews. The entire population of the village cooperated in hiding over 5,000 Jews, some for as long as 4 years, and smuggling many of them into Switzerland. With admirable understatement, one of the villagers later described his involvement. Things had to be done, and we happened to be there to do them. It was the most natural thing in the world to help these people. The author says what I was thinking. I beg to differ. This was not natural at all. These were dangerous, life-threatening choices made repeatedly over the span of 5 years. And yet, in what came to be known as a conspiracy of goodness, the entire village kept their daring work completely secret. Not a single Jew was ever turned away or betrayed or arrested in that town. Some of the organizers were themselves imprisoned. And that's where we are. Will we, knowing how powerful we are as one with God, create a conspiracy of goodness and act and take the action and take the action, not just, wow, I'm really sorry for the left out. Wow, I'm really sorry there isn't more justice. Wow, I'm really sorry that people are hungry. And if they happen to wander through, then maybe we'll help them go on their way. If I happen to see them on the street, maybe I'll behave a little differently. I'll do what I can by praying for them from afar. No, I think it's time for us to recognize our power and to realize that God is counting on us to answer the call, because we are God in this place. One of the founders of the movement in this town said, "I did not go around looking for people to help, but I never closed my door. I never refused to help someone who asked for something, and this, I think, is my kind of religion. When things happen, not things that I plan, but things set by God or by chance, when people come to my door, I feel responsible." That's our kind of religion. That's what we do here. That's why you've found this website, because we're not doing any more of the, well, maybe it'll all work out if we just trust the benevolent God, the amazing, good, powerful God who's over there. We recognize that we are looking into the eyes of the people around us and in the mirror who are the God who are right here and who are tasked with making the change, with answering the call, with opening the door every time. Don't get caught up in the loophole. You hear the loophole? I love the loopholes. My brain goes crazy with the loopholes. Oh, well, nobody knocked today. Yeah. You know, nobody, my door, you bet I would open my door. You bet I would. But, nobody knocked on my door today. They're pounding on your door with social media, with their protests, with their banners, with their signs, with their politics. Those you agree with and those who you do not are pounding on your door to pray for them, to care for them, to love them, to feed them, to house them, to understand that the economic consequences of what we're going through are just beginning, and there are going to be many hungry, homeless, desperate people, and they are pounding on your door to do something. And if you don't hear the pounding, then go into the quiet and do all the things. Find all the resources that we talk about. Do the meditations that we do. Find counseling if you need to. Find coaching if you need to. Join the mastermind group and see the amazing and expansive power of people working together and understanding their power. Commune with others virtually or in person safely that you can. Look around for the people who are knocking and who are desperate, and use your resources. Use your resources. The resources of a community, and help and create what you want to create. Because the game changer is God may do it through you, because you are not separate from God. And when you pray for God to do it, what you are praying for is the understanding that you are God who can do it. And that's how change will come. And she offers this beautiful last image. Sister Lacey says, "These are my hopes for the world, and they include that we who have abundant resources begin to share freely with everyone else in line, that our fear of strangers gives way to the risk of welcoming them." each step in that direction moves our bruised and broken world closer to the day when mercy and justice shall kiss. Mercy and justice shall kiss. Each step you make, mighty, powerful, beloved God, moves us closer to that beautiful, beautiful day when mercy and justice shall kiss. Let's do it. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, David Allen Brown. We love having you here. And you'll be back in another...
I'll be back in a couple weeks, and we'll do number two.
Wonderful.
Number one is God Himself is incomplete without you.
Wonderful.
God Himself is incomplete without you. I am the light. All of the beautiful things you've been singing.
Yes. Speaking of singing then, David Kaiser will be back next week with our wonderful music ministry here. But in the meantime, we're going to work it out with our ego, with our the strangers, with the pounding at the door. We're going to work it all out, right? Try to see it my way. Do I have to keep on talking till I can't go on? While you see it your way, run the risk of knowing that all saying you can get it wrong and think you think that it's all right. Think of what I'm saying. We can work it out and get it straight or say goodnight. Cause we can work it out. We can work it out. Life is very short and there's no time for fussing and fighting, my friend.
We can and will and do each day that we choose love, and that's what we do. This is the part of our service in which we understand and are grateful for and share on our blessings. And if you are here or wherever you are, you can take your offering or the idea of your offering into your hands. Know that there are many ways to support the ministry of this church, including lots of online ways. If you're here, there's a basket in the back. We won't be passing for obvious reasons. There's also that electric widget back there if you want to use that. But if you are from home and appreciate the work that we are doing here, then won't you please continue knowing that we are so grateful. I know that the email blast came out, and it includes a list of all the amazing and incredible things that some of which we weren't necessarily in control of, phones breaking and air conditioning going out, and yet the extraordinary prosperity of love in this community just continues to allow us to be blessed and to and to serve. So for that, we are grateful. And we say, divine love, moving in and through me, blesses and multiplies all that I give and all that I receive. And so it is. Amen. I want to make sure to mention the founding principle of this organization and unity in general is the power of prayer. And so your prayers are always welcome, received, and answered. If you do that in a formal way by calling in or sending an email, those prayer requests go on to a page that gets sent out to lots of folks all around the world. They're held in loving light and for perfect outcome for at least 4 weeks. And the prayer ministry here is full of dedicated and divine folks who love and know only the perfect good for you. If you're here, there's a formal way to do that. This mostly I just keep around to remind me myself to remind you and to remind me that prayer is important and vital, and we do it here. So please, whether you're at home, no matter where you are, utilize the power of communal prayer, not just your own, by sending it in.
Hey, David.
Yeah.
Larry Watson will be available in the gazebo after service to pray.
Perfect. That's been working out really great. Larry is here. He's actually the chair of that group, I think. And he'll be here if anyone in person would like additional vibrations. I think that does us.
Yes, I think it is. I think it's time that we all stand and we sing our wonderful song of peace.
Prayer for protection.
After we say the prayer for protection. Yes.
And together we know that
the light of God surrounds me, the love of God enfolds me, the power of God protects me, the presence of God watches over me. Wherever I am, God is, and all is well.
Let there be peace on earth.
Let there be peace on earth, and let it begin with me. Let there be peace on earth, the peace that was meant to be. In perfect harmony, let peace begin with me. Let this be the moment now. With every step I take, let this be my song.
Thank you, everyone.